Indeed. Welcome, folks, as you're joining us. We're thrilled to have you on board to enjoy our evening's entertainment. Your audio is muted, as is your video, as we're using the webinar functions of Zoom that we've all grown to know and love, or otherwise. Be sure to have your Zoom application set up to speaker view for optimal viewing of this evening's content. And we are, we might invite you to speak live in the open Q&A session at the end. If you've got a quick snippet to offer for more personal history of theater in the Carmel area here. Otherwise, we would also invite you to use the Q&A or chat functions of Zoom for the written questions that you might have as the evening's presentation goes on. So with that, I am recording this evening's presentation, so we will make that available for your future viewing. And Fred, I'll turn it over to you. It's all yours. Fred Bologna.
Thank you, Nancy. Carmel Residents Association is proud to host Stephen Moore to walk through the history of live theater in Carmel, its people, places, and more. Carmel is known nationally and beyond for its deep roots in local live theater. Stephen will share insights on the theatric sponsors, talent, and facilities over the past century surrounding us blessed to be part of this community. Stephen himself has been a significant part of this history in the past more recent decades by his acting, direction of over 100 productions, and producing over 10,000 performances for over 1 million audience members. So Stephen, we are at places and curtain.
All right. Thank you so much, Fred and Nancy. I really appreciate the invitation and the interest, and hopefully it'll be worth it. I'm going to jump right over to my screen share here and go over to the PowerPoint. All right. And then I'm going to set that from the first slide, and looks like we're ready to go. I hope everybody can see that picture of the four facilities here in Carmel. I'll do a little quiz maybe later in the presentation and see how many of you recognize all four of these. So if you recognize all four of these locations, good on you. I don't know what the prize will be. That'll be up to Nancy and Fred, I guess. So I'm going to jump right in here and the history of Carmel Theater. And of course, as many of us know, that starts with the Bohemian influence on Carmel that started just before the San Francisco earthquake, of course, and then after the earthquake took quite a leap, starting off with George Sterling, the uncrowned king of Bohemia and the poet laureate of San Francisco at the turn of the century. George came to Carmel in approximately 1905, and he became a magnet for everything, poets, playwrights, performers, politicians, photographers, you name it, Jack London, Harry Wilson, James Hopper, Arnold Genthe, Robinson Jeffers, Mary Austin, Upton Sinclair, all these people came to Carmel to see George or to visit George's retreat. For better or worse, he's credited with making Carmel famous. Today, maybe we're cursing him for making it so famous, but maybe not. George, like the rest of the Bohemians, there were a dark streak that ran through them. Suicide was quite common among a number of the Bohemians. I hate to go right to the darkness here, but it's quite interesting, and it was a running through line, a number of the Bohemians. Sterling himself carried a vial of cyanide in his pocket, and it was marked peace. And he used to say about it, he said, a prison becomes a home if you have the key. He actually committed suicide by his vial of cyanide in 1926. And that was after several others had gone that way. And I'll get into that as we move through a couple more of these artists. One person who wasn't really well known as one of the original Bohemians, although she certainly played her part, was George's wife, Carrie Sterling. Carrie, too, committed suicide by cyanide later after they left Carmel. George himself was involved all over Carmel. He was a poet, playwright. He appeared on stage at the Forest Theater several times, most notably in Mary Austin's Fire. He volunteered throughout the community and artistic endeavors. He could also be found wandering in the forest in his toga. So they were quite an interesting bunch. Mary Austin, who I mentioned earlier, George introduced Carmel to Mary. She had visited him a few times in 1905, once George was here, and 1906. Now, the interesting thing about Mary was she was in San Francisco at the time of the earthquake. And the day before the earthquake, she had a premonition that something bad was going to happen to San Francisco. And the next morning, she woke up rocking and tossing and turning and pretty much within the year had moved down to join George in Carmel and stay here for several years. She's quite well known as a novelist. Land of Little Rain, Isdro, Taos Pueblo, a number of novels, lots of short stories. She wrote for magazines and periodicals at the time. She was part of that Bohemian circle that included Jack London and Ambrose Bierce, George Sterling, of course, a poetess named Nora May French, who I actually will get to in a moment here, Jimmy Hopper, who I also will get to in a moment, Sinclair Lewis. So she too was part of this early Bohemian circle. She was one of the founders of the Forest Theater. There's some dispute as to who actually founded the Forest Theater, but it was really quite a group effort between Mary Austin and a fellow named Michael Williams and Herbert Heron. Herbert Heron, of course, became known as the founder and the guiding light, but he had help in those early days actually creating the space and truly founding the site. Mary and Herbert Heron, and like I said, a fellow named Michael Williams. Mary did not commit suicide. Mary lived until, I believe, 1926, really adopted New Mexico and Southwest United States as her kind of land that she wrote so many great novels and about. So it was she kind of put her mark on Carmel and then moved on. Next, of course, and very well known, Jack London, novelist, short story writer, playwright, and adventurer. He was an athlete as a younger man. He loved to sail, loved to play, you know, all sorts of games. He was a heavy drinker. You can see the list of works, just some of his works. He wrote dozens and dozens of novels, hundreds of short stories, hundreds of poems, quite an output. There's a dispute as to whether Jack London committed suicide or not. I think most historians come down on the side that he didn't commit suicide. He died of alcoholism, uremia, and he was on morphine. So some speculate that maybe an overdose of morphine was involved with his death, but most of the historians come down on the fact that he was terribly ill, he was in pain, he was on heavy dosages, and if morphine played a part, that it was more likely accidental than on purpose. John London had a credo, which I'm going to read. I would rather be ashes than dust. I would rather that my spark should burn out in a brilliant blaze than it should be stifled by dry rot. I would rather be a superb meteor, every atom of me in magnificent glow, than a sleepy permanent planet. The function of man is to live, not to exist. I shall not waste my days in trying to prolong them. I shall use my time. So that poem, which he wrote or was included in a collection of London stories that wasn't published until 1956. Some have looked at that poem and said, oh, see, he committed suicide. But he didn't write that poem the day he died. He didn't write that poem the week or the year he died. That was his credo. And he was more one for living every moment and living as long as he could, as long as he was still producing, which he was doing all the way up until the day he died. Then there were two others in that early group, James Hopper. Although he's credited as a novelist, he really only wrote one or two and not great acclaim. He was a journalist. He was a war correspondent. He wrote a lot of short stories for magazines and for newspapers for publication. He was a football star in his youth. He actually didn't die until 1956. He was one of the younger groups and didn't join in on the suicide clan. But Jimmy, he was great friends with Jack London and would accompany him on sailing trips. And there's a story about Jack London when he left for one of his round the world tours on his boat, the Snark, that he hoisted an odd flag as he passed under the Golden Gate and out through San Francisco Bay. And it wasn't an odd flag, it was a football jersey. And it was Jimmy Hopper's football jersey. So it was a kind of a nice little tribute to his friend Jimmy, who was not accompanying him except for with his jersey. So Jimmy Hopper was one of those early Bohemians that you'll recognize from a picture I've got coming up. And then this last sort of original group of the early 1907 Bohemians, really, was Nora Mae French. Young lady, she came to Carmel in 1907 after having some acclaim, some notoriety as a young poet. She suffered from depression. She was 23 years old when she came to visit George and Carrie Sterling in 1907. She was one who carried a vial of cyanide with her. Sadly, at 23, she felt she had contributed all she wanted to contribute, all she could contribute. And her depression, you know, reinforced that feeling that she was finished. So she attempted suicide in mid-November with a gun. And because her hand was so shaky, she missed a save, shooting off a lock of her hair. So later that night, after everyone went to sleep, she pulled out her vial of cyanide and drank it. While she was lying in bed next to Carrie Sterling, who was fast asleep, and they discovered her body basically in bed next to Carrie that next morning. It was quite a sensation in the newspapers, the national papers, about this young poetess committing suicide in George Sterling's wife's bed, only because they were cold and warm and keeping warm under the covers. They didn't have a relationship. Nora May was actually depressed over a string of sort of failed affairs that she had with gentlemen of note in the Bay Area, another one of the reasons why she kind of fled to Carmel. So sadly, at 23, as I said, she ended her life. Here's a great picture, famous, many of you will know it, I'm sure. And that is four out of the five that we were just talking about. There's George Sterling on the left, and Mary Austin next to him in the sand there. There's Jack London, and here's Jimmy Hopper. And this, again, this is quite a famous photo. It's used quite a lot in articles about the early Carmel Bohemians. This behind them, and this would be one of those other questions, if I was doing this in live, I'd say, how many people know what this building is? And this is the old Carmel bathhouse, which was at the bottom of Ocean Avenue and just to the south, I believe. So this was the Carmel bathhouse, which was literally what it sounded like, a giant pool indoors that was a community bathhouse. What's really interesting about this shot, it was shot by Arnold Genth, who is quite a famous photographer. His photos of the San Francisco earthquake are quite well known and are represented in collections, you know, all across the world, museums that cover the earthquake. And this is actually a picture of Arnold Genth taking that picture we just saw of the four Bohemians. So I think this is so cool. And the fact that this came down to us and was saved is sort of a testament to the pack rat nature of a lot of these Bohemians, the Herbert Heron collection, the Jack London collection, all the collections at the Carmel Library. It's so wonderful that we have such a store of archives that really document early Carmel and the effect that the Carmel Bohemians had on it. So there's the Carmel bathhouse up at the top to the right. There's George Sterling, Mary Austin, Jack London, and Jimmy Hopper being photographed by Arnold Genth. So I think that's pretty cool. Here's a shot by Arnold Genth, pretty well-known shot of the earthquake aftermath in San Francisco. And this really was the trigger that caused dozens, if not hundreds, of artists, writers, musicians, painters, playwrights, college professors, speculators, you name it. They descended in on Carmel after the earthquake. Lots were cheap. They were $10 down and whatever you could pay per month. And often they gave you two lots just because they wanted you to have more land. So it was quite a time. So the earthquake, you know, really was the trigger that caused Carmel to explode and become, you know, first an artist colony and then a famous artist colony with reporters covering it and people joining in, tourists coming down, etc. This is just a few of the famous writers and artists who lived in Carmel, who came to visit George Sterling primarily. He was such a magnet. And then some of them stayed, created homes here, started to create art here, or they were teachers here of the art school that was in residence at the early Golden Bough in the 1920s and 30s. So quite an amazing list, mostly writers of some sort, whether it's a novelist or a playwright or a journalist or a muckraker. But then the beauty of the place, you know, got to be known, and photographers and painters and sketch artists and you name it, they sculptors, and they all came here and started to use this beautiful area as their inspiration. So that kind of was that early Bohemian section, 1905 up through, you know, 1910 or so. And then we get into the stages. They were out in the forest, and they were maybe going to the Pine Inn, which at that time was on Ocean Avenue, right at the bottom of right at Ocean and Unipero, before they put the Pine Inn and rolled it on logs down Ocean Avenue to its present location. But it was one of the few indoor locations where the artists could gather and read works. But in 1907, and here's one of those pictures, if you guessed the Carmel Arts and Crafts Clubhouse as the probably the most unknown picture, then you win. I'm not sure what you win, but you win. So in 1907, the ladies of the Arts and Crafts Club, which was a social group, and it was pretty much the wives of all the main businessmen in town. And they got together and decided the Carmel needed art. It needed performance. It needed writers and the whole gamut that any community needs art, needs a cultural component to it. So they created a clubhouse, which was really Carmel's first cultural center, Carmel's first theater. There was a small hall where they could act out the plays they'd written. They would gather and read. There's a great term that George Sterling used in his diaries, which is private theatricals. So they would get together and read their private theatricals to each other, and I assume give notes to each other and kibitz and argue and create as a team. So it must have been that little clubhouse just must have been teeming with excitement and creation and energy. I love this quote from the Mercury Herald, which is up in the Bay Area. By 1914, a fever of activity seems to have seized the community, and each newcomer is immediately inoculated and begins with a great enthusiasm to do something with plays, studios, and studies. So by the early part of of Carmel's existence, prior to it becoming a city, it was already becoming well known in the States and beyond for being this hotbed of cultural activity. During that time, in 1910, the Forest Theater was founded. They had the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse, but they didn't have a true theater. And so many of their dramas were historical dramas, mythology, Greek adaptations, so many took place outside, that they wanted to create an outdoor amphitheater to present their own work and the work of California writers, and ultimately expanding that repertoire to Shakespeare and the classics and children's theater. And those were some of the early things that they did. You know, the focus was on original plays by California authors, Shakespeare and the classics, and children's theater. Here's Herbert Heron, the founder of the Forest Theater. He came to Carmel a few times in prior to 1910 as a visitor, and then moved here for good in early 1910, and immediately began scouting out a location for an outdoor theater with Mary Austin, and the two of them found the outdoor Forest Theater site. They talked the Carmel Development Company into giving them 16 lots right there where you know, the present site of the Forest Theater, and actually advancing the funds to create the first set of benches up the hillside where the present auditorium is now. At that time, the stage was an earthen mound surrounded by trees on a hill. They opened in 1910. With a biblical drama called David, and over 1,000 people were reported in attendance. This included the entire, population of Carmel, much of the peninsula, and then quite a train and wagon loads of folks coming down from San Francisco. They hauled two giant carbon arc lamps over the hill by stagecoach and set them up to illuminate the auditorium and the stage and probably a lot of the forest at the same time. By 1911, they did their first Shakespeare, which was Twelfth Night. And Twelfth Night goes down, I think, in history of the Forest Theater as being the most often produced Shakespeare. It was produced in 1911, and then in 1942, 56, 72, 2004, and 2010. And I think there's been at least one more production since then. But this is a great photo because it shows that this was before there was a stage. So you have the wooden benches, and you can see that, yeah, there could have been 1,000 people there. Look how crammed in they are. And it was also much wider, the auditorium. It was before the fire pits, so the auditorium was considerably wider than it is now, set between the two fire pits. But you can see that this stage is just dirt at the bottom of the hill, and it is surrounded by natural trees and a natural backdrop of the older trees and bushes and what have you. So quite an amazing location. And I believe that tree is still there, up audience left, when you're at the auditorium. The Forest Theater has a number of fabulous stats. It's amazing how much activity, how many shows. Just a quick like overview of some of the things that, you know, past David, in 1911, Land of Heart's Desire was produced by the Carmel Arts and Crafts Club, and that was a Mary Austin piece. By 1912, there were three groups producing at the Outdoor Forest Theater. So there was the Forest Theater Society, which is now and long since defunct. There's the Carmel Arts and Crafts Club, which sort of we have taken over at least their site and hopefully a lot of their ambition and their identity, and then the Western Drama Society, which focused on California playwrights, which I mentioned before. And in those early days, there was a lot of strife between the groups as to who would produce what and who would get, you know, to use the Forest Theater first or at all every season. So there's something about that site, the Forest Theater, that always stirs controversy. I think, you know, personally, I think it's because, you know, it's such a special, unique, magical place that anybody who sets foot there just wants to consume it, wants to really, you know, see what they can do with it, how far they can take it. So it's interesting. In between 1915 and 1924, over 50 plays and musicals were staged. In fact, by 1924, there was so much going on that the groups were really fighting with each other over talent, over contributors, over materials. Everybody was really competing. So in order to solve that competition and get back to a more creative space, a number of the producing groups were disbanded, and they all came together under the auspices of the Carmel Arts and Crafts Club. So down at the Golden Bough, the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse, the Carmel Arts and Crafts Club was seen as kind of the parents in the room, I guess. And everybody agreed, it's like, okay, we're going to let the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse manage the space for us. Then we'll all be part of the club and the membership, and we'll all work as a group to produce a season where everybody gets to produce something. And it was a real unifying moment for the groups using the Forest Theater, and it really worked out to everyone's benefit, especially given the limited resources and the sheer amount of shows that theater wanted to, or the groups using the theater wanted to produce. In 1925, they were so successful that they were able to buy the land, the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse, they were able to buy the land from the Carmel Development Company, who had sort of donated it in theory, but kept control of it. So in 1925, they donated the land to the what was called the Forest Theater Corporation at that time, and that was basically that united group under the supervision of the Carmel Arts and Crafts Club. So at that point, they continued producing. By 1934, the Forest Theater had seen its 100th production, and that's only in 24 years. And the show that was the 100th major production was called The Man Who Married a Dumb Wife. and Herbert Herron directed it, but his wife designed all the sets and costumes. So I imagine there were probably some amusing conversations at the dinner table between Herbert and Helena Herron. So would have liked to have been a fly on the wall when they discussed the choice of that particular show. So that brings us up to the Roaring Twenties. And it's interesting, we were just talking about this at our Pack Rep board retreat, that because we're talking about now, we're in this pandemic and what's going to happen when you know everybody is able to go out again. And I reminded them that in the pandemic 1918, there was such pent up frustration of being at home, of not seeing theater, of not going out to the games, etc., that the result of that pandemic was the Roaring Twenties. There was such pent up, you know, energy that the Twenties came along, the masks came off, and there was a renaissance of theater and music and dance and film and what have you. So I predict that when we return to whatever the next normal is, that there's going to be quite a renaissance of people going back to the theater and the movies and dance and music and all those activities. So in the 20s, as part of this resurgence, between 1922 and 1923, again, the competitive nature of these early Carmel Bohemians and artists, there were two 300-seat auditoriums, each being built in our little town of Carmel. There was the original Theater of the Golden Bough on Ocean Avenue, which is pictured here from 1925. And that is currently, it's gone now, but it was located behind where the Cottage of Sweets still is. In fact, the Cottage of Sweets was the box office. And if you go back to the back side of the Cottage of Sweets, you can see a little window that opens up, and that was the old box office window for the Golden Bough. So, like I said, in between 22-23, there were these two theaters. There was this one, the original Golden Bough, Theater of the Golden Bough, on Ocean Avenue, and there's another shot of it. There's the Cottage of Sweets, and then you can see that massive building that was behind, with a tower above it. That was the original Theater of the Golden Bough, which I said is gone now. This is one of the better pictures showing how big that building was and the front of it. This is Ted Custer, right here seated, second from the left. This is Ted Custer, and this is the teaching staff of the Theater of the Golden Bough's Summer School for the Arts, which Ted Custer created, and they had quite a personnel roster, and they taught everything from theater to painting and dance and everything in between. This is, again, outside that original Golden Bough on Ocean Avenue. This is the staff, and this is a number of the students. This is one of the first graduating classes of the school there. Then, sorry for the blur, but this is just a great picture, and it's Ruth St. Denis, who is a well-known dancer, traveled all over the country. And it's just a little note from her to Ted. And I just love this. It's not like these folks were dramatic, were they? Not at all. So this is the original interior of that theater, the Theater of the Golden Bough. Tall ceiling. It had a domed ceiling that could be covered, turned different colors with light. And then over the stage, it had another dome. So when these curtains opened up, the cyclorama went up behind the stage and above and wrapped above. So it became what they called like a sky dome, and they could project clouds and different scenic elements up there. Another interesting thing about this theater, if you look at the seats, it's all wicker chairs. And I don't know whose brilliant idea that was. Maybe they were comfortable, but I'm sorry, isn't wicker a little squeaky? And can you imagine 300 or 400 wicker seats all in an indoor theater? So, but there they are. For better or worse, they decided on wicker chairs for the Golden Bough. Then in 1935, the Golden Bough burned after a production of By Candlelight. So yes, you heard that true, and it's pretty famous. A lot of you already know this, but By Candlelight was an original adaptation of a German script that was an early version of Gaslight. Remember Gaslight, the movie, the old movie thriller? Well, I believe By Candlelight was an early version of that. And so Ted produced it, directed it. It opened the middle of May, third weekend of May, 1935. And on that opening weekend, sadly, it burned to the ground, including most of those wicker seats. So fortunately, remember I mentioned the back in 22-23, they were building two giant theaters in town at the same time that were competing with each other. Well, the second theater that was being built in 1922-23 was the Carmel Playhouse, also known as the Film Mart, and ultimately known as the Golden Bough Playhouse after 1949. Fortunately, by 1949, Ted Custer had acquired the property after the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse simply couldn't compete with the grander, more well-known Golden Theater of the Golden Bough on Ocean Avenue. So in the late 20s, early 30s, Ted Custer purchased the Arts and Crafts Hall, which is what it was called at the time, and he was using it as a rehearsal hall and also as a film location for art films. It was the only, actually, art film house between Los Angeles and San Francisco at the time. So he was able to grab a number of great titles as they traveled between the two cities. So there were hundreds of movies produced or presented every year at the Golden Bough once movies became a thing. So this is the Golden Bough when it was first built. And just try to remember this little stairway that comes down. I love this element. I miss it from the current building because we have a stairway in that location, but it's an interior stairway. And it's so charming with the exterior stairway and the open rails there. So this is the Arts and Crafts Hall in 1923. Again, it became the Carmel Playhouse and the Film Art and ultimately the studio of the Golden Bough. In 1949, they decided to produce By Candlelight. Yeah, you know, it's coming. Most of you know this story, but for those who don't, be prepared. The actors from the original performance of By Candlelight, remember that was 1935, so this is 14 years later, they got together with Ted and said, Ted, we're getting older. We still know our parts. We'd like to do By Candlelight. We got cut short. We weren't able to resume the production. So Ted said, yes, it's great. I love it. I adapted it. It's my show. I'll direct it. I'll update it. And so they presented By Candlelight again, middle of May, 1949. And yep, it burned down that very weekend. Again, they don't know arson, but they don't know beyond that what it was. And unfortunately, very sadly, during this fire, not only was the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse, which is here at the front of this build, this shot on your left, but it also burned down the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse, which as you can see by the gable behind. So very sadly, not only did we lose the second Golden Bough, but we also lost the Arts and Crafts Clubhouse, which, as you can see, pictured from the Casanova side down below here. But you can see the side gable there that would be on Monteverdi between on the north side going down to Casanova. So 1949, burned to the ground. But this time, first, here's just another shot. It was kind of famous stories from that era was to heck with the building, save the trees. So the building they really didn't, you know, pay a lot of attention to. They mostly saved the neighborhood houses and saved the trees. And instead of sold out, they were burnt out. And the very next Monday, they were able to present the show at Sunset Center. The show must go on. The show will go on. But they they were able to produce it at Sunset Auditorium, because at that time it wasn't Sunset Center, of course, it was the school. So that was the story of By Candlelight. Here's a picture of the aftermath of the original Golden Bough on Ocean, here on Monteverde. Apparently they had quite a chimney going down. We don't have that. We don't have an interior fireplace here, unfortunately. And then this is Ted Custer. Oh man, you can imagine the second of his giant theaters to burn. And he spent basically his entire, you know, wealth, his fortune between these two theaters. So the only way he was able to rebuild was by appealing to the community. And he did an interesting thing. He sold stock in the new Golden Bough, and as your return, you got play tickets. And I always thought that was a very clever fundraising idea. So he sold shares of stock, I believe, for $25 each. And people could buy a single share or 100 shares or what have you. And you got theater tickets back as your investment. So I think that's pretty cool. And the community definitely rallied and built the new theater. In 1950, they started building the new theater. Here you see it under construction. This is our current theater here on Monteverde between 8th and 9th. And there's a really cool shot. This is them pouring the cement for the Circle Theater on Casanova. So that is pretty cool. And they did a darn good job because of all the renovations we've done. The floor of the Circle Theater is that same floor today as it was, as you can see these guys laying here in 1951 or early 52. So in 1952, the Golden Bough opened, 52 to the present, and this is the current building that you see before us that we are in the middle of getting ready to remodel for the first time in almost 70 years. So it's been a great run, this old building. Here's another shot at sunset, a little blurry, sorry about that. But it's nice to see it all lit up at night with people, with our ushers in the lobby waiting to start the show. And then we go into the next phase of sort of Carmel, the facilities. We already mentioned that Sunset Auditorium was already a thing. It was the Carmel School, of course. In 31, it was built, including that Gothic-inspired main auditorium with its seating for 700. It was a school. It was a performing arts center. And in 1964, it was bought by the city of Carmel from the school district when they were getting ready to build the new Carmel High School up at the top of the hill. And the city bought it, renamed it the Sunset Theater, and eventually obviously became known to us as Sunset Center. And then, of course, in 2003, following a $22 million renovation, the theater reopened to its beautiful site today. And, of course, it's home of the Bach Festival, and we've had artists travel from throughout the world. As a 22,700-seat auditorium, I would venture to say that on a per-seat basis, Carmel has one of the most expensive and well-equipped concert halls, certainly in the United States. That happened in the 30s. Also in the 30s, Forest Theater. It's been going since 1910. It saw a resurgence in the 20s and 30s. It was going like gangbusters, hundreds of performances, but no money to renovate. And so when the WPA came along and was offering money to cities and counties and states, unfortunately, the Forest Theater Corporation, the Carmel Arts Crafts Clubhouse, was a private entity, private nonprofits, and the WPA was for public facilities. The Arts and Crafts Clubhouse management made the difficult decision to cede the Forest Theater to the city of Carmel with the understanding that it would stay a theater for all time. As a result, it was eligible for the WPA funding. And because of that, they were able to build a true stage with a workshop underneath, which is now the site of first the Children's Experimental Theater, and now Pat Rapp School of Dramatic Arts is actually housed in the bunker underneath the Outdoor Forest Theater stage. A lot of people don't even know that little bunker is there. But here you can see them rebuilding the auditorium. It's not nearly as wide as it was in the past. They made room for the fire pits. They created a center aisle. Before there wasn't a center aisle, it was stadium style seating at the Forest Theater. Here's another shot from the other side where you can see they're building the workshop underneath, which ultimately first became dressing rooms and then became a school, Children's Experimental Theater, run by Marcia Hovick. Then you can see as they're kind of finishing it off and the full scope of that project. Also check out the trees, the number of trees. The trees building right through the stage, which are no longer there. They were there when I was a kid. But the amount of trees, you can also see how thin they are. Of course, now all those trees are like 3 feet in diameter or more. All right, so moving on with 1940. The renovation, the WPA renovation was complete, and Herbert Heron reopened the Forest Theater with what he called the Carmel Shakespeare Festival. At the time, Shakespeare festivals were in vogue. Ashland was going like crazy, so Herbert Heron wanted to create the Carmel Shakespeare Festival, so he did. Also in 41, Robinson Jeffers had appeared on the scene, and he actually wrote a play specifically for the Forest Theater, Tower Beyond Tragedy. And then the first time the Forest Theater went dark was during the war, went dark for 2 years, 43-44, and didn't reopen until 1945. Why, you ask? Well, they didn't want lights from on the coast indicating where the coastline was to anybody flying over. So the West Coast blackout affected the Forest Theater. So it reopened in 45, and by 1949, the theater had shown 136 plays, including 64 world premieres, and then a number of other notable stats. 49, the first Forest Theater Guild was founded. They were active through 1962, and they disbanded at that point. Then between 63 and 70, it was pretty much a closed down facility other than the occasional, community fundraiser. Several times the city actually discussed closing the facility and getting rid of the theater and creating housing on those lots. Thank goodness they didn't. In 71, the second Forest Theater Guild was formed, and that's the guild that continues to this day. They're the longest running resident theater group still performing at the Forest Theater. They actually brought in Dame Judith Anderson, who with the help of Robinson Jeffers, did excerpts from two of Jeffers' writings, Medea and Tower Beyond Tragedy. In 1984, Pac Rep and yours truly started producing at the Forest Theater. We started with Medea by Jeffers. We thought it apropos. In 1990, we reactivated the Carmel Shakespeare Festival name and have been doing Shakespeare at the Forest Theater ever since. And in 1997, we started doing family musicals, started with Walt DeFerria as one of our directors, with Oliver. And ever since then, we've been doing our family musicals at the Forest Theater. And that one production every summer has turned into Carmel's most highly attended single title production. Almost 10,000 people a year will see our family production at the Forest Theater. So this is what it looked like in 1993. Check out the large trees right behind the stage, which framed the stage so beautifully back then. Again, that center tree, the trees surrounding the stage. This was a picture from Julius Caesar. Again, now by 2014, that tree backdrop had started to thin out due to both some tree sort of accidents during the renovation, as well as just natural trimming. But then due to oak worm disease and age, now that's what the Forest Theater looks like. So that's super sad. And now the city has started to plant a bunch of trees, and the previous administration planted some. The current administration is planting a bunch more. So hopefully these trees that you see here that are lower are going to keep growing, and these trees here will grow up, and we'll have that natural backdrop that used to be all the way around the theater, and now it's just over here on the stage right side, the audience left side of the auditorium. So wow, what a difference, huh? There was a renovation plan for the Forest Theater, as you all know, but unfortunately it got closed down because of access, ADA access and proper exiting. So unfortunately, the city had actually budgeted almost $3 million to do a renovation and upgrade of the Forest Theater, new seating and bathrooms and dressing rooms and all that stuff. And unfortunately, all that money had to be spent. There was going to be a new entrance. There were going to be dressing rooms and more dressing rooms and handicapped access and all that. But unfortunately, all the money that the city had to go instead toward the ADA and electrical and all the problems that were discovered in 2014 that caused the shutdown of the Forest Theater. So my goal, you know, one of my dreams is to one day get back to the Forest Theater. And I feel like I am motivated. I will raise money. I will lead a community campaign to actually renovate the Forest Theater and give it the love that it was gonna get prior to that money being spent, necessarily so, on access and electrical and all that. So, you know, one of my personal goals is to get back to the Forest Theater and finish it off. So some notable endeavors that I'm going to breeze through because there's just a little few minutes left here and I want to show you a quick video. I'm not going to read all this stuff. The Carl Cherry Center up on Guadalupe and 4th is one of the Carmel's just hidden little masterpieces. And interesting, Carl Cherry, he invented the Cherry Rivet, and that's how he made his fortune. And it was his fortune, what was left of it, that funded the creation of the Cherry Center for the Arts and continues it to this day. So the Cherry Rivet was what helped America win World War II because they were able to pop rivet together airplanes and jets and all that stuff. So interesting little side note. We used to have a dinner theater in Carmel. It was on Dolores in between Ocean and 7th. It's called Carmel Studio Theater. Right now, I believe it's a new master's gallery. So the studio dinner theater, that was run started in the late 50s and ran right up through 1990 when it closed down due to economics. And of course, the only thing that it could afford to be a business in Carmel was an art gallery. So now we've got another art gallery. And then there was the Community Theater of the Monterey Peninsula. That was created at the Circle Theater, outgrew the Circle Theater, moved to Sunset Center, Carpenter Hall, back there on Mission. And then basically closed down in the late 70s. Again, economics, it was hard to keep it going. During that time, Children's Experimental Theater was created at the Community Theater. It moved over to the Circle Theater and then ultimately moved to the Indoor Forest Theater. So as each of these sort of entities began to grow and achieve success, they moved into successively bigger theaters and bigger locations, and ultimately the Outdoor Forest Theater and the Indoor Forest Theater became such a perfect location for a school, with the kids able to sort of run around in a fenced area and climb trees and all that. So those were a few little extra theaters here in Carmel. And of course, I mentioned Children's Experimental Theater. That school, created by Marsha Hovick, lasted almost 50 years. And I was a student of Marsha's. I went through her programs in middle school, high school, went to work for her for several years. And on her deathbed, literally, she said, "Stephen, keep the school going." And so we did. And now it's the Pat Krebs School of Dramatic Arts, and we're trying to continue Marsha's vision for instilling creative confidence in children. It's not that these children all become stars and go into movies and theaters. It's that they learn confidence through the arts, how to speak, how to work with their peers, had to be on time, all those things. Marsha is what taught us all. Then in 2011, Carmel High School finally got its theater. Believe it or not, of all schools, Carmel did not have a real theater until 2011. We had a double classroom that we built some platforms in and built a stage on and could fit maybe 60 or 75 people in. But it wasn't until 2011 that Carmel High School, of all schools, finally got a legitimate theater. Beautiful architecture, inside, lovely size, for a high school. It's not a mausoleum. It's not a giant auditorium where students, you know, beyond students' ability to project and fill the space. So it's really a lovely space, just right size for a high school theater. And then, of course, finally, Pack Rep Theater, professional theater, came to Carmel. We started not at the Golden Bough Playhouse, at the Forest Theater in 1984. Been producing there ever since. And then in 1994, the Golden Bough Playhouse went on the market as 4 residential building lots. They were going to knock our dear theater down and build 4 little McMansions for Carmel. Fortunately, the day that the sign went up, I happened to be driving by, and I immediately went to my board, said, look, we've been interested in buying our own home instead of renting all the time. It happened to be twice. It was $1.2 million, the Golden Bough Playhouse. We were looking at buying a building about $600,000. So once my board got over the shock effect of going for $1.2 million campaign to save the Golden Bough, we launched it, we announced it to the community, and within 4 months, we had raised half the purchase price. There was such love in this community to save the Golden Bough. The Packard Foundation put the rest of the price into a loan, which we retired 6 years later. And so now Pack Rep owns the Golden Bough Playhouse free and clear, and it will be here for eternity now as a performing arts center. We also had the zoning changed so that it is now a performing arts site, and hopefully that will withstand the test of time. As you know, we are now in the middle of a remodel, our phase 2 remodel. In our first phase remodel, we added the revolves back in 2011. This was a double revolving deck. We also rebuilt the Circle Theater. So it's safe, and it's got, it's fully sprinklered. It's got earthquake safety. It's got a little higher ceiling than it originally had. It's got air conditioning. We added tech projectors and screens and to the Golden Bough to make it more multi-purpose like it was in the old days. We added, you know, visual effects. And then in 2016, we added solar to the Golden Bough. So now the Golden Bough is 100% off the grid. We have no carbon footprint from electrical needs. In 2018, we took one of the bunkers, this concrete bunker that's basically hold the building on the hill, and we created handicapped accessible dressing rooms, handicapped bathroom, handicapped shower. Then in 2019, as the first step in this current remodel, we rebuilt the box office and the entry, made it really quite lovely, and it's kind of a taste of what the rest of the new building is going to look like. So now we're up to phase 2, which is the new auditorium. Turning the auditorium itself into, which is a sort of mostly flat movie theater, and turning into a true regional theater style building with stadium seating, raked seating, so that the people in the back row, you know, have as good a view as the people in the front row. All the seats are turned in to the center of the stage. We've got box seats, little balconies. It's really going to be quite lovely. Also, by raking the auditorium and raising those upper rows in the air, if you see here, these are kind of the raised auditorium of the seating above, and so we're able to create a little inner lobby right below the back half of the auditorium. As you know, right now we have a lobby rated for 125 people for a 300 seat theater, so it'll be nice, especially in the coming age, to have more space for our audiences, more bathrooms, more common area, more space just to spread out. And here's a couple more views of the auditorium, the way it will be. And we hope to break ground within the next 3 months. This is the Guthrie, which is sort of one of our inspirations, and it gives you an idea of the kind of auditorium we will create, just not as big. This is, again, the Guthrie. Our auditorium won't be quite this big, but it will wrap around the stage, our revolving stage, the way you see this picture does. So it is really going to, you know, get rid of that fourth wall and create the same kind of intimacy that the Circle Theater has, just a little bigger. So that's kind of the past and the present of the Golden Bough. And as you can see, with our revolving stages and wrapping the audience around the stage, we're giving a nod to the original theater of the Golden Bough on Ocean Avenue that had the thrust circular stage and had the audience wrapped around it, which is really breaks that fourth wall and makes every audience member practically a member of the show. So here's the Golden Bough. As we move forward, we've been playing around with different renovation ideas. We desperately need more office space, so we had a simple renovation where we just sort of pulled the offices forward a little bit. But then we started really looking at the whole outside of the building, which is not an architectural masterpiece, shall we just put it that way? It's kind of the Safeway-style design of the 1950s. So we challenged our architect to work on a phase three, sort of something we could come up with in the future. It could be 10 years away, it could be 20 years away, it could be 5 years away. It will require a lot of work, require a zoning change. But let me just kind of move toward it. Here we go. So here's an image that Richard McCann, our architect, who is a world famous theater designer and historic theater renovator. I mean, everything, he's worked on every project you would probably know about, ranging from the Pasadena Playhouse to the Curran and Gurry Theaters to Nashville to Lincoln Center to Disney World. So he worked on, you know, expanding the gables, adding Carmel character to the building. Here's another view from Monteverdi, kind of up close as if, here's a squirrel's view, I guess. Another view, you know, with a sort of photo view. How we add the elements to the building, and then some side views of the building. This is not what we're doing. Nobody freak out. This is not what we're doing. This will require a zoning change and another $2 million capital campaign, but it's an idea for the future of how to make the Golden Bough building on the outside as beautiful as it is on the inside. We're looking at various treatments of the gables in terms of kind of an Elizabethan playhouse kind of feel to it, like these buildings from old England, and thus the color. It's the first step into going towards this palette of colors. You'll have to bear with us on that one. So that is very close to the end of this presentation. I've got a short video to show you. I realize I'm a couple minutes over. Nancy, are we good for the video?
Yep, go for it.
Okay, so I need to stop share for a moment. I need to open up my video. I'm going to start share again and sit back. And here we go. So yes, we're going to finally make the men's room truly handicapped accessible and add a stall. I know that's of extreme importance to everyone. We're adding more ladies' restrooms as well, and another family restroom inside the new lobby, which we're heading into now. So this will be the second lobby, what we're calling the stadium lobby.
Count to three.
So this will be an addition.
And you'll be in a world. Take a look, and you'll see into your imagination.
And then we'll go into the main auditorium.
With a spin, traveling in the world of my creation, what we'll see will defy explanation. If you want to view paradise, simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it, want to change the world, there's nothing to it. Thank you. No life I know to compare with pure imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly wish to be. If you want to view paradise, simply look around and view it. Anything you want to do it, want to change the world, there's nothing to do. I know to compare with your imagination. Living there, you'll be free if you truly.
All right.
All righty. That's great. So why don't you update us? So is this the little video snippet that you gave us? Mm-hmm. Is that what's in this current timeline? And
it is indeed. Yes.
That's reopen and kind of fill us in.
We hope to break ground in 2 months or so. We're just, you know, we have to go through all the, we're still getting corrections back on our permits and this and that and going back and forth, but we're working through that process. The city's being great. So hopefully we'll break ground within a couple of months, and then that renovation will take through the end of the year.
Great. So then any of the productions that you would do would need to be elsewhere?
Yes. Well, since we're obviously still waiting for that time period when live performances can then again go on in front of live audiences with actors being able to touch each other and breathe on each other, that's still a ways off. So we're hoping we reach that level by summer, August, September, in which case we would produce our annual season at the Forest Theater. We've been wanting to do Shrek at the Outdoor Forest Theater since actually 2014. That was the show that was going to be there when it closed down. So we'd love to do it there at the Forest Theater. If not this summer, then summer of 22. But we've got our fingers crossed that, you know, maybe, and it really depends on the vaccine and how much herd immunity there is, and whether performers will be allowed to perform next to each other without masks and play love scenes and dance with each other and all of that, you know, which you just can't do socially distanced.
Yeah, indeed. You have a lot of great photos, especially in the earlier section of some of the old timers and facilities, et cetera. Where did you compile those from?
Oh, well, a lot through internet research, through archives, UC Berkeley has an archive, the Carmel, of course, the Carmel Memorial Library has such a great archive. We were given a lot of material from Herbert Heron's daughter, Constance Heron. She knew of us, and when she was sort of in her last days, she called us to her bedside, and she said, you're the group that does the Shakespeare, right? In Carmel. You know, I'm like, yeah, that's us. And she said, my father, Herbert, kept a bunch of stuff in this room next door. Do you want it? We were like, yes, we don't care what it is. Yes. So it was posters and programs and Joe Mora maps and artwork and newspapers, pine cones and symbols and just tons of stuff that we've had on our walls here at the theater. We've given a bunch of it to the library. We've sold some of them as unique items to, you know, for people to have in their homes. It's quite a collection.
And going kind of into the dark side, you had mentioned early on in the presentation that there were a lot of the Bohemian groups that were quite suicidal, and you told some of those stories. Do you have a sense as to why that might be?
Well, I think, there was a shared kind of feeling amongst a number of these. You heard that in Jack London's poem, that we're placed on this earth to make a contribution and then we're done. And these people took it to an extreme. They were, you know, like poor young Nora Mae French at 23 felt like she was done and she'd accomplished what she needed to on this earth. And I think they all believed in an ever after of some kind. And I think also, sadly, you know, there was probably some kind of cultish, you know, I hate to use that word, but it's true. When a group of people starts to have a sameness or a similar attitude towards something and they all have their vials and there's got to be some kind of weird kind of peer pressure or something, mm-hmm. you know, and I can only liken it to kind of a cult atmosphere, yeah. Where we all believe this weird thing and we all believe it.
Fatalistic,
And commit our lives to it. So that's the best I can kind of pin on. Well,
and at that time, of course, they'd just gone through the pandemic and World War I. And it was, you know, it was a difficult time. And then the depression followed. And so there were interesting historical negative forces, you could say. Or life experiences that made it extra difficult.
Well, and life was harder. I mean, you got to think it's, you know, there were times where for, you know, months on end, it was cold and foggy and dark and, you know, we have a lot of more creature comforts. So it's easy to fall into the doldrums, you know, when you're just trying to stay warm.
Indeed.
Yeah.
And a question from me, the Golden Bough in its original form was on Ocean there, as I think you'd mentioned.
Right.
And then in its current location, and both having had in their first instances a severe conflagration that took its toll. So why didn't the name change? It seems to me that there might have been a benefit.
Well, I think so. I mean, by candlelight, I think the bigger question is, why did they do that show again?
Yeah, that's true.
People
that's
ask me if I'm going to do by candlelight. I'm like, no, never, no.
Well, where did the name Golden Bough come from? Do you know?
Interesting. Yeah, it's from mythology. And in Virgil's Aeneid, Odysseus, I believe, is it Odysseus or who calls out for the golden bough to lead them through the dark wood. And there's another a story about how the golden bough had to be a branch off the golden bough had to be taken to give to the to ride the little rowboat across to the Netherland to the underworld, mm-hmm. and you had to present the golden the branch of the golden bough as part of your entrance to the underworld.
All right, interesting. Yeah. Great, thank you very much. All right, so I think we're at a wrap with the questions. So let me pass the ball back to Fred here for some closing comments.
Thanks, everyone. With all the great history you shared, there is no doubt that we are all anxious to fully support and enjoy live in-person theater in the months to come. Thanks again, Stephen, and best wishes on a speedy facilities refresh at ACREF.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
so much. And thank you for the invitation.
And here are a few CRA reminders. Our annual biannual Citizens of the Year nominations are open until February 15th. visit our website for more info on this honor and process. Our next Zoom program is on Thursday, March 25th at 5 p.m. Charlie Osborne will present My Grandfather, Sam Morse. To receive our e-newsletter and printed newsletter, we welcome you to join us officially at www.carmelresidence.org. On behalf of the CRA board, we wish you all health, safety, and a happy Valentine's Day coming up. Thank you for attending.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Stephen.